I'm Martin Long, Director of Professional Education at Heidelberg Engineering, and I'd like to show you the Spectralis Glaucoma Module Premium Edition. This is like a toolkit for glaucoma evaluation, and we use essentially three components. We look on the neuroretinal rim, and there we use Brooks membrane opening as the true anatomic location of the disc margin. And we can measure from Brooks membrane opening to the inner limiting membrane the minimum amount of rim tissue that the patient has. Then we move to the peripapillary nerve fiber layer, and we use the circle scan for this, and we can see how the profile of the nerve fiber layer is and also the thickness of the nerve fiber layer. Finally, we move to the macular area and we do a complete posterior pole scan, where we can then segment all of the layers of the retina, and particularly looking on the ganglion cell layer, where we're looking for notching of ganglion cell layer across the horizontal midline and looking for imbalance or asymmetry between the upper and lower hemifields. So let's do a scan and show you what we do, and then look at the information that we get afterwards that might help you with your glaucoma evaluations. So what we have here is an anatomic positioning system, and we're going to automatically identify the fovea and then four primary points of Brooks membrane opening, which should be the true anatomic disc margin. And we're going to do this before we do any scanning, and the reason for this is that everybody has a different orientation, a different angle of the fovea to the disc, and so we need to isolate this before we start scanning. So what we're going to do is start fovea detection. I wait for the blue bars to complete and we confirm that position. Then we move to the optic nerve, start BMO detection, wait for the blue bars to complete and we confirm BMO position. So the anatomic positioning system fixes the location of the fovea to the center of the optic disc. And this is for every individual patient. Now if I ask my patient to slightly move their head, you can see that that is fixed, and this is confirming that we have true track, live eye tracking working, and this gives you very high reproducibility on your follow-up. Now we fix the axis of the fovea to the optic nerve center for each individual eye, and now we can start scanning. So I'm going to press acquire, and we're going to do 24 radial scans of the optic nerve head and identify 48 locations of Brooks membrane opening. Then we're going to do three nerve fibre layer circle scans, one at 3.5 millimetres, one at 4.1, and then 4.7 millimetres. We're complete. Now we're going to do the posterior pole scan to look on the whole of the macular area. And we see the retina there in position, and I'm going to acquire the image, and we're going to do ART9, an averaging of 9 scans per B-scan. And then we can segment all of the layers and look on the ganglion cell layer. So let's do our follow-up now. And you can see here that we've automatically preset the location of the fovea to the disc. And here we're going to use, again, TrueTrack live eye tracking. And this was originally developed by Heidelberg for the Spectralis. And it's one of the very nice features that gives us very high reproducibility when we come to look at follow-up. So we're going to acquire the image again. And again, 24 radial scans, 48 locations of Brooks membrane opening, and three nerve fiber layer circle scans. And each circle scan has ART100, so it's an averaging of 100, which is also a very high quality contrast and detail. Let's again do follow-up on the posterior pole, and we move to the retina. We're in position, all preset, and we acquire our image. And if I ask our patient to sit back away from the camera, you can see that our scan has stopped. And this demonstrates the live eye tracking function that we have. And so because the machine doesn't recognize the retina any longer, it stops. So if I ask our patient to sit back in position, and I get in position, we can continue exactly where we left off from before. And you know that you always have very nice, accurate scanning, and especially for follow-up. So let's look at our results and see what we've got. We can actually extract the infrared fundus image from the OCT. And this is nice because I use this normally as a control. It's an infrared reflectance image, and I can see the configuration of the optic nerve, and I can see the configuration of the neuroretinal rim. I also can see how is the vessel trunk, and typically the vessel trunk is in like a C-curve position, and this is important to know because this will affect and dictate the location of the double hump position on the nerve fiber layer profile when we start to look on the nerve fiber layer. This is a structural diagnostic image, and actually you can see very clearly that there's a focal nerve fiber defect here. Typically, healthy nerve fiber is very highly reflective and bright, and sick nerve fiber is looking dull. And so you can see that focal nerve fiber defect there already, just in the infrared confocal fundus image. We are going to look systematically every time. We take a holistic approach to glaucoma, and so we're going to look step one at the neuroretinal rim. Then we're going to move to step two, the peripapillary nerve fiber layer. And then finally, we're going to follow the axons round, and we're going to look at the ganglion cell layer and look and see if there's any notching of ganglion cell layer across the horizontal midline, which is where we will normally see changes relative to glaucoma. So let's look at our OCT. We're going to look first of all at the neuroretinal rim, and we have identified 48 locations of Bruch's membrane opening, and we can measure from Bruch's membrane opening, which should be the true anatomic disc margin, from Bruch's membrane to the inner limiting membrane, we can measure the minimum amount of rim tissue that the patient has all the way around the optic nerve. We also can, from these 48 locations, identify what is the size of the disc according to those true anatomic positions. And in this case, this patient has a disc size of 1.93, which we might consider a fairly average size disc. And so I would think then the profile of the neuroretinal rim should follow pretty much this green line identified in the middle of the normative range. If the patient has a smaller disc, let's say 1.5 millimeters squared or less, then I would expect that all the nerve fibers are squeezed together, and naturally you'd have a little bit higher position to your neuroretinal rim, and we wouldn't expect to see cupping. That's a very bad sign if you have a smaller disc. On the other hand, if it's a larger disc, 2.5 millimeters squared or more, I would expect the nerve fibers to be spread out, and naturally you would see more cupping. And from the neuroretinal rim position point of view, I might expect the rim to be a little bit lower in profile. This patient has an average size disc, and I can see from the profile that there's a depression here, more nasal superior area, but a larger depression in the temporal inferior location, and that is actually consistent with what we've already seen in the confocal infrared fundus image. So typically from the OCT point of view, I say three strikes and you're out. And this is the first strike, the neuroretinal rim. Don't like the look of the profile of that neuroretinal rim. So let's go to step two, and we look on the peripapillary nerve fiber layer circle scan. The beauty of this is that you can see very clearly the actual tissue of the nerve fiber layer here, and you can see whether or not the machine has segmented that nerve fiber layer properly. And you can see that we're not picking up any vitreous membrane that might give us any some false readings in terms of thickness. So this is a very nice feature to be looking on. And if this is looking good, you can be sure that the profile of the nerve fiber layer is good, and that the thickness measurements are reliable. And if we look on the profile, you can see that we've got a very large chunk out of our temporal inferior hump. And this is consistent with that depression that we saw on the neuroretinal rim. So we've got a correlation between the neuroretinal rim and the peripapillary nerve fiber layer. And so therefore I've got two strikes out of three from a glaucoma point of view for this patient, unfortunately. Let's move finally to the macula, and we've done a posterior pole scan across the whole of the macular region here, and then we can segment all of the layers of the retina, and particularly interested in looking on the ganglion cell layer. So we go to the posterior pole, which is a full retinal thickness map. And so long as you haven't got comorbidity and retinal condition combined with glaucoma, you can see patterns of damage relating to glaucoma even with a full retinal thickness map. So I can see a focal nerve fiber defect here, like a river going to the lake, that focal nerve fiber defect, and I can see the associated notching of ganglion cell between the inferior hemifield compared to the superior hemifield. And we use the principle of asymmetry, rather like glaucoma hemifield test in visual fields. We use the same principle, although we're looking at thickness changes. So here you see the difference between the upper hemifield and the lower hemifield, and these black areas here indicate that we have changes which are at least 30 microns thinner than the corresponding location in the upper hemifield. So this is an important observation in glaucoma. We look at asymmetry within the eye and also asymmetry between the eyes. Now we can segment the layers, and let's have a look on the ganglion cell layer. Then it becomes very obvious that we have an early ganglion cell layer notching here in the lower hemifield that's following on from these axons from the optic nerve around, and you can see a value of 25 on average thickness of ganglion cell layer in the inferior hemifield compared to 46 just opposite across that horizontal midline. So this was a typical pattern, like a snail shell, that we might see in an earlier stage of glaucoma. We also have deviation maps which show you how does the patient compare to normative data, and it's very visual. So here we can see that actually the loss of ganglion cell layer or damage compared to normal is even further temporally than we might think relative to that snail shell pattern. We also can evaluate the full retina, and if we look at the full retina, you can see those changes coming from the optic nerve out. We have depression or loss of tissue there if we look at the full retina. If we look at the nerve fiber layer, you can see the full extent of the loss of nerve fiber layer compared to normal from the optic nerve right out, starting to join up to the ganglion cell layer, and there's the ganglion cell layer loss. And so we have really a view of the whole picture. We take a holistic approach, and we don't look at just one parameter. We look from the neuroretinal rim to the nerve fiber layer, to the posterior pole, to the ganglion cell layer, and we have much more confidence in our evaluation of that eye from a glaucoma perspective, and may even be able to identify patterns that are non-glaucomatous optic neuropathy as well.